Well, that's it. There's more from me in a little while.
Well, at 20 minutes to five, we can now say the decision taken in 1975 by this country to join the common market has been reversed by this referendum to leave the EU. We are absolutely clear now that there is no way that the Remain side can win. It looks as though the gap's going to be something like 52 to 48, so a four-point lead for leaving the EU. And that's the result of this referendum, which has been preceded by weeks and months of argument and dispute and all the rest of it. The British people have spoken, and the answer is, we're out.
So, why did Britain vote to leave the European Union? Lots of people tend to focus on the short-term arguments, like maybe it was all just a fight in the Conservative Party, that's what caused it, or it was just David Cameron's fault for calling the bloody referendum in the first place, or maybe it was just the 2008 financial crisis that caused everything, or perhaps it was super short-term, and that you think that the entire future with our relationship with Europe was decided in a several month long campaign, and it was leaflets and arguments and debates and a big red bus and Benedict Cumberbatch that caused the whole thing.
Let's take back control!
I have a different theory.
Cameron was derided for calling the referendum for so-called party management purposes. Of course, Jeremy Corbyn is now calling for a referendum for his own party management purposes. But putting that aside, party management is a legitimate function for a party leader. If you have your MPs who are going back every weekend and talking to their constituents and talking to their association members, desperate for a referendum on this crucial issue, which I think was bubbling away for years and years and years, this is not something that... There's a narrative now that Cameron in 2016 opened a Pandora's box and suddenly out jumped all this atavistic xenophobia and people were lied to by a number on a bus and suddenly decided to vote to leave on this kind of crazy whim. It's obviously rubbish. The country's had this very profound divide on Europe from the very beginning, and this has gone right the way back through history for very obvious reasons.
Britain is an odd little country. We're an island in the northwest corner of the European continent, stuck between a large landmass on one side and the North Atlantic Ocean on the other, with several competing air masses overhead, and the North Atlantic jet stream, all conspiring to create a climate far milder than other countries at the same latitude, with oddly variable weather, unique in all the world. Over 500,000 years ago, Britain was covered by a vast ice sheet and was physically connected to Europe by an enormous raised chalk land bridge, which was destroyed by a mega flood as an enormous lake broke its banks. The very first Brexit. Over time, sea levels rose and fell, ice sheets came and went, waves of human migration arrived and were pushed back or wiped out completely. As the last ice age ended, Britain was once again connected to mainland Europe by a stretch of low-lying plains known as Doggerland. But again, this European reunion was not to be. Sea levels rose, and underwater landslides off the coast of Norway known as the Storegga Slides created a tsunami, which submerged the already drowning Doggerland and left behind the island we know today. But so what? Britain is an island nation, but does that actually mean anything? I think it means everything. I think that the country, the sense of place, has shaped the British national character, the national identity of the country, and explains why we Brits are the way we are, and ultimately explains Brexit itself. In his book, Where We Are, philosopher Roger Scruton explains it like this. It is the image of the country itself as a settled spot of earth that crystallizes the prevailing sense of who we are. It is a commonplace that our temperate climate and uncertain weather are connected to our phlegmatic character and are partly responsible for our habit of downplaying emergencies. But the influence of the country's physical attributes goes far deeper than that. The extraordinary variety of soils, the rock formations, the abundance of estuaries and inlets, the surrounding ocean currents, the accessibility of each part of the mainland to every other. Such factors have created a unique experience of place, which expresses itself in our institutions and laws, in our attitude to the rest of the world, and in the daily life of our people. In Harry Mount's book, How England Shaped the English, he goes into great detail about how the British landscape and climate have all shaped the British national character, how our cramped island life has led to our desire for privacy and our insularity, as well as our awkwardness around strangers, whether they be from without or within our islands, as well as our remarkable tolerance, among other traits. Now, when Roger Scruton talks about how our unique experience of place expresses itself in our institutions, the best example of this is our law. In Britain, the common law is bottom-up compared to the top-down Roman-based civil law system that presides in European courtrooms. And this is reflective of the country itself, where throughout history, the British have always self-organised into little platoons, creating charitable associations, private foundations, societies, groups, clubs, guilds and trade unions, creating schools and hospitals and other institutions privately, in a sort of do-it-yourself mentality. English common law is a flexible, evolutionary, bottom-up system built on precedent over time, case by case, based on individual interactions, decisions and argumentation. On the other hand, civil law is a system of decree dictated from above, a top-down framework of codified statutes. While the common law is the tool of the citizen to empower themselves to fix their issues in the appropriate manner, civil law is the tool of the state to enforce decrees upon their citizens. Scruton outlines how this reflects a deeper philosophical difference between Britain and Europe. The British idea of government has been founded on the conception that authority flows upwards from the citizen through the courts to Parliament and the offices of the state, and not downwards from the sovereign to the citizen. This explains why we view our politicians the way we do, why they're always on daytime politics programmes and evening panel shows, bombarded by questions and lambasted by the British public. Because the common law provides a ceiling beneath which we all reside, and thus the British believe that anyone with power over others must be accountable to those people. They have no power but that which we confer upon them, which we lend them and can choose to take away every time we return to the ballot box. They are not our masters, but our servants. I'm sorry.
When all the economic and other arguments are melted away, I feel strongly about it because at bottom, this erodes the importance of the vote. For people in this country who don't have money or power in industry, it is the vote that is their main safeguard for the future. And common market membership devalues and downgrades the vote because it prevents people using the ballot box to adopt policies, change men who adopt policies and thus change taxes and laws. Because in future, if people vote yes on Thursday, then whatever the outcome of the general elections may be, much real power will rest in the hands of those who will not be affected by our elections. Now, there are men who give their lives for the right to self-government, independence, democracy. There are many men in the world today in prison for those rights. And we are being invited to give up those rights for whatever purposes we shall be discussing. And I think that makes this the most important point in British political history.
It also explains the fundamental tension between Britain and the European Union. Our society has advanced in an easygoing and sometimes shambolic manner, emerging from particular agreements and individual choices. Order is the unintended byproduct of compromises and courtroom disputes. It conforms to no plan, but only to the constraints implied in our fluctuating agreements, including our agreement to reject those who have plans for us. The ability of the British to just get on with things without a plan was neatly summarised by Stig Abel, journalist and author of How Britain Really Works, on BBC Politics Live a few months ago.
I think Britain has either worked or never really worked more or less how it does today. The great triumph of being British is muddling through. It's always been this way. We don't have a particularly ordered system. Most things that we rely on were created and then added to and amputated and fiddled around with. So we're a great nation of muddlers. And that's true of the NHS, it's true of the education system, it's true of virtually everything. I mean, it's true to a point of almost absurdity with Brexit, the giant muddle of the last 2 years, and the Prime Minister who just believes if we crash on ahead, we'll somehow get through it. That's kind of how Britain's always been run. We're not a great nation of strategists. We're not a great nation of resets. We don't have giant revolutions. We don't have moments other than the last one in 1945, when the end of the Second World War, when there was a reset. We don't really do it. We just sort of pluckily carry on. And the downside of that is we get stuck in ruts. And the upside of that is we tend not to have sort of violent demonstrations.
Roger Scruton contrasts this kind of British order out of chaos, an order of contradictions, compromises, paradoxes and muddling through, with that of the EU. The idea of order instilled in the European treaties is of quite another kind. It is order imposed from above and passed down to civil society by a system of inescapable regulations administered by a bureaucracy that is accountable to no one beneath it. but only to those from whom it is recruited who have never paid the price of their mistakes. And that is the key word, accountability. For Scruton, it's not an abstract concept, but a key feature of the British people that originates, as he writes, in no particular person, no particular office, no particular procedure or institution. It grows in the place where we are. The fact that we're an island nation goes further than just shaping our institutions and the kind of people we are. It's also played a large part in defining British national identity, or Britishness. Now, Great Britain was officially formed as a nation by the Treaty of Union in 1707, which fused three nations into one. But Britishness didn't come about because of some kind of mixing between Welshness, Scottishness, and Englishness. Nor did Englishness just consume the other two. Britain was more like a patchwork of regional identities and varying cultures and customs, with uncertain areas of Welshness, Scottishness, and Englishness thrown into the mix. The concept of Britishness was superimposed on top of pre-existing loyalties in response to contact and conflict with an external other, with a big O, and that other was France. While other factors such as internal trade, increasing connectivity via road and print, the uniting force of Protestantism and war all played a part, it was mainly through a strong sense of being dissimilar, being different from those without, that proved the cement of Britishness. That's not to say that Britain was special in that way. Identity is half what you are, half what you aren't, or you define yourself against. People do it, groups do it, countries do it. It's not special. But Britain was in the useful position of being an island nation, and thus more easily able to define itself as other, separate, and special from those across the sea. As Linda Colley explained, it was partly geography that underlay this marked sense of difference. The simple fact that Great Britain was an island, the encompassing sea, was a vital defence and a highly effective frontier, keeping Britons enclosed and together, as well as keeping enemies out. But the sea could also be imagined as a telling symbol of identity. In France, as in most continental European states, national boundaries would fluctuate throughout the 1700s and long after. While the borders of European countries bent and broke, Britain's boundaries after 1707 were more or less fixed and settled and defined by the sea, almost preordained. As a clergyman said celebrating the Act of Union, "We are fenced in with a wall which knows no master but God only." In an article entitled Why Britain Keeps Its Distance, the German author, commentator and journalist Thomas Keilinger also places the blame for Brexit on Britain's geography, explaining the country is simply wired differently than we continental Europeans are, because an island is an opt-out to a continent. He contrasts our cool detachment from the continent with Germany, surrounded as it is by the landmass of nine neighbours. Like Linda Colley, he also emphasises the role of the sea in our national character and identity. Our history as a maritime, seafaring nation has demanded adaptability, flexibility, and the necessity of working without a plan. In much the same kind of shambolic, make-it-up-as-you-go-along kind of attitude that Roger Scruton says is inherent in the British way of life. Fundamentally, Keilinger states, the British have an aversion to subjugate the future to preordained decisions that are set in stone, decisions from which there is no going back and that preclude all chances of learning from trial and error. And a brief look at history shows us just how important being an island has been in terms of our defence. Unlike almost every other European nation in the period 1707 to 1837, Great Britain never experienced a major invasion from without. The effect of this physical and psychological distance from war and the continent, instead of pacifying the population, was actually to make the British response to war more unabashedly chauvinistic, because, unlike most other European nations, Britain was able to savour military glory without ever having to pay the price in terms of civilian casualties and large-scale domestic destruction. But even further back, Britain's relationship with Europe has always been on and off, to say the least. Guardian columnist Simon Jenkins wrote in 2018 about how, in his opinion, Britain is destined to rejoin the EU at some point in the future, because, in his estimation, Brexit is actually the ninth time that Britain, or England, has left Europe. The most obvious being Henry VIII taking back control from the Roman Catholic Church in the 1500s. Historian David Starkey has written that, after Henry split from Rome, England went from being a good Catholic country in the mainstream of European affairs to a 16th century rogue state. In plans for the elaborate coastal defences that Henry commissioned, we can see how England no longer defined itself as part of Europe, but as separate from it, a nation apart. Catholic Europe was now the threat, the launchpad for invasion. In other words, Henry was the first Eurosceptic.
The king that I'm most interested in, as everybody knows, is Henry VIII. And Henry VIII is a monster of selfishness and everything else. And yet, the carrying out of the first Brexit, which is what the Reformation is the central event of English history. And it seems to me that the vote for the second Brexit wouldn't have happened without the first. No, the Reformation is the moment at which, for the first time, you conceive of England as separate and distant from continental Europe. It's the moment at which you conceive of the Channel as the widest strip of water in the world. Before that point, remember, from the Norman conquest to the Tudors, England is part of a cross-channel empire. The Channel is a means of communication. It's under Henry that you conceive of England as a fortified island, this Shakespearean notion of the jewels set in a silver sea. So he is the monarch who absolutely stands England on its head. Monster that he was.
Napoleon Bonaparte referred to the English Channel as a mere ditch, yet one that even he was unable to cross. And interestingly, when Admiral Nelson defeated Napoleon's fleet at the Battle of Trafalgar in 1804, he also extinguished Napoleon's hope of invading England and fulfilling his dream of unifying Europe, saying, "We must have a European legal system, a European appeal court, a common currency, the same weights and measures, the same laws."
Now Adolf Hitler stood just as Napoleon had stood more than 100 years before, and looked across the English Channel to the one fighting obstacle that stood between him and world domination. The chalk cliffs of Britain rose sheer and white out of the choppy waters. And beyond, a little island, smaller than the state of Wyoming. Crush that little island and its stubborn people, and the way was open for world conquest.
Boris Johnson hit on this point during the EU referendum, in his typical bombastic and hyperbolic manner. The whole thing began with the Roman Empire. The truth is that the history of the last couple of thousand years has been broadly repeated attempts by various people or institutions, in a Freudian way, to rediscover the lost childhood of Europe, this golden age of peace and prosperity under the Romans, by trying to unify it. Napoleon, Hitler, various people tried this out, and it ends tragically. Jeremy Hunt also offended the EU when he said,
"The EU was set up to protect freedom. It was the Soviet Union that stopped people leaving."
Crass and blunt as these statements are, and whether you agree with them or not, they're proof that the British have a different, detached, maybe even a more arrogant view of history than Europe. Perhaps a historical hangover from our Protestant past and our belief that we're particularly special in God's eyes, or a result of our triumphalist view of history from our victories in war. Or maybe, on the other hand,
"Member states are reluctant to transfer new sovereignty and powers to the European Union."
Aber wir sollten, das sage ich sehr bewusst auch aus der Entwicklung der letzten Jahre, wir sollten an der Vision arbeiten, eines Tages auch eine echte europäische Armee zu schaffen.
We will need to move towards a federation of nation states.
Pour l'Europe, de développer ce que j'ai appelé Weltpolitik, politique Fähigkeit. Cette capacité à jouer notre rôle pour prendre de l'influence sur les cours de choses mondiales. L'Europe doit devenir davantage un acteur souverain dans les relations internationales.
She's also voiced support for a United States of Europe like Switzerland, Germany and the US.
The world of tomorrow is a world of empires in which we Europeans and you British can only defend your interest, your way of life, by doing it together in a European framework and in European Union.
Perhaps they have a point. And then, in the mid-20th century, we finally come to the European Union. Roger Scruton outlines how, post-World War II, the elites of the defeated countries became sceptical of the very idea of the nation-state itself. And in particular, Germany. Faced with the horrors that had been committed, they could no longer identify themselves with their own country, and instead sought a transnational European identity based on the rejection of nationalism. He also claims that the French have an existential commitment to the European project out of a lingering fear of Germany. This explains the hastily advanced common currency as a way of equalizing French and German power following the alarming fact of German reunification. For France and Germany, it was a move in an existential game, as necessary to soothe the fears of the French as to persuade the Germans that they are more, not less, European, after reassuming their status as the greatest continental power. Thus, in 1951, the six-member European Coal and Steel Community was created, with the support of Winston Churchill, to integrate key military resources between countries so as to make war in Europe impossible, and with the intention of creating a union of states with a shared form of government. In 1957, it evolved into the European Economic Community, but Britain hung back, keen to maintain its own ties to the US and the Commonwealth, eventually joining in 1973. But, according to Matthew Goodwin and Roger Eatwell, while Britain did vote to remain in the EEC in 1975 by two-thirds, there was no enthusiasm behind it, just the hope that it would boost Britain's stagnating economy. Support was wide, but never deep. In The Road to Somewhere, David Goodhart emphasizes Britain's historical differences from Europe as a key reason why Britain was never emotionally invested in the European Union, or keen on political integration. Although weakened and exhausted after 1945, Britain had experienced several hundred years of more or less unbroken success. The gradual evolution of liberal constitutionalism, no serious internal conflict since the 17th century. The Industrial Revolution, empire, victory in two world wars in the 20th century, and the creation of a democratic welfare state. All of which inspired strong attachment to venerated political institutions that it did not want superseded. Which Goodhart compares to France, Germany, and Italy's experience with dictatorship.
Prime Minister, Rector, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. Willing and active cooperation between independent sovereign states is the best way to build a successful European community. To try to suppress nationhood and concentrate power at the center of a European conglomerate would be highly damaging and would jeopardize the objectives we seek to achieve. Europe will be stronger precisely because it has France as France, Spain as Spain, Britain as Britain, each with its own customs, traditions, and identity. It would be folly to try to fit them into some sort of identikit European personality. But working more closely together does not require power to be centralized in Brussels or decisions to be taken by an appointed bureaucracy. Indeed, it is ironic that just when those countries, such as the Soviet Union, which have tried to run everything from the center, are learning that success depends on dispersing power and decisions away from the center, there are some in the community who seem to want to move in the opposite direction. We have not successfully rolled back the frontiers of the state in Britain, only to see them reimposed at a European level, with a European superstate exercising a new dominance from Brussels. Certainly we want to see Europe more united and with a greater sense of common purpose. But it must be in a way which preserves the different traditions, parliamentary powers, and sense of national pride in one's own country. For these have been the source of Europe's vitality through the centuries.
Britain was basically comfortable with the EU of the late 80s and early 90s, one of high economic but limited political cooperation. But integration ramped up, more and more countries joined. Tony Blair opened up the British labour market to acceding former communist states several years earlier than he needed to. And concerns around law and sovereignty merged with fears over rising immigration and Islamist terrorist attacks. Through the 20th century and the rise of the European Union, there also run the threads outlined in national populism, the revolt against liberal democracy. Those threads are the four Ds: distrust, destruction, deprivation, and de-alignment. Deep-rooted societal changes that have been in motion for decades, but which have largely gone unnoticed. If you're interested, I'd recommend the review of the book I did last year. It's definitely worth a read. in 2018, Matthew Goodwin, in an article called Britain's Populist Revolt, argues that the fundamentals in terms of the referendum campaign, the fundamentals favoured Leave and had been baked in long ago, as we've seen. The British had perhaps always been suspicious of power hierarchies that felt remote and lacking in democratic accountability, but they had also been wary of identities that claimed to supersede the nation. Dreams of a pan-European demos had only ever appealed to a small number of cosmopolitan liberals. He goes on to explain that between 1992 and 2016, an average of 62% of Brits said they were British only. Only 6% prioritised a European identity. The UK's leading sophologist, or pollster, Sir John Curtis, presented the issue of European identity in Britain like this.
The United Kingdom, because we are sharing our sovereignty. And the fundamental failure of the European project in this country, in my view, is that it failed to instill in the UK population the sense that we are European. And at the end of the day, what tends to underpin a willingness to share a set of political institutions is a common sense of identity. So why, albeit with some considerable fraying at the edges in Scotland and Northern Ireland, for the most part, the majority of the population in the UK accept the authority of Parliament and government, etc. Well, because in part we feel British. So we're all us, okay? The problem for the European project in this country is that only around 1 in 8 of us or so feel European. Europe is other. And therefore, it was always impossible for, basically, to use the simple colloquial lingua, why are Brussels bossing us about? Because Brussels is not us. It's that funny place on the other side of the English Channel of which we do not feel part. They are the Europeans. We are the Brits, all right? So that's the fundamental issue of identity. And now you can look at the European Union's own Eurobarometer data, and we are the only country together with Greece where a majority of the population at the moment deny that they are European, okay? So the truth is, we've never been more than semi-detached members of the European Union. We've been in it for what we could get out of it. And when during the last 10 or 20 years, we have experienced by our own historical standards, very high levels of net inward migration. And the brutal truth is that with freedom of movement, you cannot control immigration. This presented a potential problem of legitimacy.
This fundamental difference between British and European identity was also picked up by Germany's first post-war Chancellor, Konrad Adenauer. In early 1950, he claimed that Britain is obstructing all efforts at European integration. She seems to regard herself more as a neighbour of Europe than as a European nation. Thomas Keilinger, writer, journalist, and London correspondent for German daily Die Welt, also describes an exchange between Churchill and Adenauer in December 1951, which illustrates the two opposing views which have defined Britain's relationship with Europe. Churchill told Adenauer, "You may rest assured, Great Britain will always stand by Europe's side." To which Adenauer replied, "Prime Minister, you disappoint me somewhat. England is a part of Europe."
Suez made clear that Britain could no longer impose its will on the world. But Britain reached, I would say, a quasi-equilibrium in the late 1960s and early 1970s. Decided that it was part of Europe and should apply to join the European Union. So I would say that Britain resolved, in a way, its crisis. But this also makes clear that, in another sense, crises never get resolved. A couple that has had marital problems and they decide to stay together, that doesn't mean that they're guaranteed to be happy for the rest of their lives. They may have another round of marital problems. And similarly, in the case of Britain, now some of those same issues are coming up again. You may settle them, or you may settle them the same way or a different way, but these issues are geography guarantees that these issues will come up in the future, because Britain will always be an island and will always be close to Europe, so you will always be struggling with this question.
Now, I'm not saying that this was always going to happen, that being an island meant that for 500,000 years Brexit was inevitable. Simply that it lay the ground, quite literally, for people removed physically, psychologically, and historically from their continental neighbours. A whole host of factors have been shaped by our island nature, and many, if not most, have inclined the British towards independence. A sense of security from being at home in a country of fixed boundaries, and suspicion towards, and the demand for accountability of, distant powers seeking to impose rules from abroad and above.
Indeed, I recognise that when the British people voted to leave the European Union, they were not just voting against Brussels. They were voting against London too, and against all concentrations of power in remote centres.
But a million other factors played a part, and the EU referendum itself definitely could have gone the other way. But I doubt that would have kept the lid on growing British Euroscepticism for very long. We are in the midst of a mass identity crisis in much of the West, and in Britain, without the old forces that bound us, war, religion, and overseas other against which to contrast ourselves, and in the face of mass migration, rapid change, and the ongoing technological revolution, internal divisions have resurfaced and old national identities have returned. The pillars of our national identity have eroded, but with nothing to replace them with. That's one positive outcome of Brexit. We will once again have an external other on our doorstep against which we can define ourselves and help shape our national identity into the future as an independent, sovereign nation, but with global trade and internationalist cooperation on everything from security to climate change. The EU is not an other to be hated, fought, or feared, but a neighbour against which we can define ourselves and shape our identity. Many people say that the EU is undemocratic. Whatever your thoughts on that may be, why not define ourselves against it? Why not make Brexit only the start of more regular referenda, more localised decision-making? Why not devolve more powers to local areas and get more people engaged in the democratic process? Maybe set up citizens' assemblies, introduce proportional representation, abolish the House of Lords, or perhaps more radically, Stig Abel, among others, has suggested relocating Parliament northwards as an effort to redistribute the social, political, and economic capital that's too often focused on London as a kind of black hole. As with all of these things, there's no reason why we shouldn't just do them anyway. Belinda Colley makes a powerful case that having an other to define ourselves against has been a really important factor in shaping our national identity. Whatever your thoughts on this may be, I think Leavers and Remainers alike can agree that Brexit is a historical event that will be debated and taught about in history classes and politics and across the world, really, for decades, if not centuries to come. Britain is leaving the European Union, but what comes next is anyone's guess.
But if we have been sceptical, and if we have been anxious about the remoteness of the bureaucracy, if we have been dubious about the rhetoric of union and integration, if we have been half-hearted Europeans, then it follows logically that with part of our hearts, with half our hearts, we feel something else, a sense of love and respect for European culture and civilization of which we are a part. A desire to cooperate with our friends and partners in everything, creatively, artistically, intellectually, a sense of our shared destiny.